Chapter 1 of The Sea Lady by H.G. Wells. The Coming of the Sea Lady. 1. Such previous landings of mermaids as have left a record have all the flavour of doubt. Even the very circumstantial account of that Bruges sea lady, who was so clever at fancy work, gives occasion to the sceptic. I must confess that I was absolutely incredulous of such things until a year ago. But now, face to face with indisputable facts in my own immediate neighbourhood, and with my own second cousin Melville, of Seaton Carey, as the chief witness to the story, I see these old legends in a very different light. Yet so many people concerned themselves with the hushing up of this affair that, but for my sedulous inquiries, I am certain it would have become as doubtful as those older legends in a couple of score of years. Even now, to many minds. The difficulties in the way of the hushing up process were no doubt exceptionally great in this case, and that they did contrive to do so much seems to show just how strong are the motives for secrecy in all such cases. There is certainly no remoteness nor obscurity about the scene of these events. They began upon the beach just east of Sandgate Castle, towards Folkestone, and they ended on the beach near Folkestone Pier, not 2 miles away. The beginning was in broad daylight on a bright blue day in August, and in full sight of the windows of half a dozen houses. At first sight, this alone is sufficient to make the popular want of information almost incredible. But of that you may think differently later. Mrs. Randolph Bunting's two charming daughters were bathing at the time in company with their guest, Miss Mabel Glendower. It is from the latter lady chiefly, and from Mrs. Bunting, that I have pieced together the precise circumstances of the sea lady's arrival. From Miss Glendower, the elder of the two Glendower,